Navigating and leading large organizations while confronting challenging and demanding circumstances is hard and tiring work in the best of times. Nothing can be more true, certainly, than in the face of circumstances such as those that our community has collectively and recently faced. Reaching out for assistance, especially from those with experience, knowledge, expertise, and unfortunately, that firsthand experience of being there where we are now entering, is something that I believe that organizations such as ours need to do. During these times, on uncharted grounds for us in so many respects, I decided to reach out to Dr. Rob Evans, who's here with us this evening. Dr. Evans is a clinical and organizational psychologist and the executive director of the Human Resources Relations Services in Wellesley. Rob received his undergraduate degree from Princeton and his doctorate from Harvard. He's a former high school and preschool teacher and a former child and family therapist. He has consulted in more than 1,700 schools, public and private, throughout the country, as well as internationally, and he's worked with teachers, administrators, and boards, and speaks widely at educational conferences. His particular interests are in crisis intervention and helping schools and communities cope with change. Undergirding all of that is improving adult relationships within our communities, between schools, and between our families. I've had the pleasure of meeting Rob many years ago while I served as a principal in Needham. Their community itself that was recovering from the unfortunate circumstances of a number of student suicides. He worked closely with my administrative colleagues and I there as he sought to provide support and helpful guidance as we embarked upon the often challenging work that of being a school leader, especially during times of crises. Dr. Evans was kind enough to visit with our faculty and staff at the high school last week, as well as the leadership teams, and assisted my own team in charting our course as we tried our very best to navigate these incredibly emotionally charged and difficult circumstances. I, along with some of my colleagues, knowing Dr. Evans as we do, could not think of somebody more perfect to begin to engage this conversation this evening. Just before Rob takes the microphone, I'd like to point out for those of you that are here, if you could, to share with your friends and neighbors the fact that this session, thanks to Rob and his graciousness, is being recorded and it will be made available in the near future for those that were unable to be here tonight. With that, Rob?
I'd like to say that I'm really happy to be here, but I'm not. I'm glad to be here, but I'm not happy to be here. And we have lots of ground, much more to cover than we have time to do tonight. And this is, together with the program next week with Denise Pope, whom I know, and I urge you to come to that event. You're one of a number of high schools that are actually in the greater Boston area now working with Challenge Success, and I know of others who are considering doing it, and I think it'll be a good continuity. And we can't cover all sorts of things tonight, and what I'd like to do, if I can, is just a couple. I want to talk a little bit about some of the realities about adolescent suicide, and I want to talk a little bit about some of the things you can all do to help keep your kids safe. And I need to preface it with a couple of remarks. First, I never got to meet either Matthew or Tom, and I've never met their families. And I'm gonna share some general facts with you that are statistically true, but I'm not acting as if I know that these apply perfectly by any means. I'm not saying anything about that. And second, among the many things that are hard about this, and that I've learned just from experience, is that if you gather 20 people, just at random, 20 people, 25 people at most, the odds are very high that at least one of those people has had a suicide somewhere in the family, not that far removed, either out to a cousin or up to a grandparent, or certainly through a friend or some other connection. And I've never seen any stats on that, but I have seen it in dozens and dozens of schools. So for all of us, I'm one of these people, any sort of suicide has a special resonance. And I'm assuming in a room with this many people in it that there are a number of you who would also be in the same camp that I'm in. And one reason that's important to me is that for any of us who are parents, any of us, but certainly those of us who also have this other piece of history, it's hard to think of a worse nightmare than losing a child this way. And it's hard, at least for me, the closer you are to it, the worse it seems. And yet, by the same token, if we're not careful, that kind of fear that it inspires and the anxiety and so on can lead us in directions that aren't so helpful and obscure some things that are helpful. And so I'm going to present what may seem to you like some bad news, some numbers and stuff, but also some good news, because most of what is likely to help you keep your kids safe is simple. It's not always easy, but it's not fancy. It really isn't fancy. Can I just check first, those of you whose oldest child is in the middle school, we have any of you here tonight? Some of you. And the oldest child is elementary, are there any of you? Oh, a couple, all right. And high school, the oldest kids in the high school here, most of you, and beyond. Right, keep your hands up, don't put them down. The rest of you, turn around and spot these people, find them. If I don't get to something you are having trouble with your kid about, ask one of them, because they will have been through it. And the last piece of introduction is this. A topic like this, actually almost anything that has to do with raising children, whether at home or at school, is often treated, we often talk about it as a problem. And I think of it as a dilemma or a series of dilemmas. And the distinction is important to me. I learned it from the former superintendent of schools in Wellesley, Matt King. And what Matt used to say was that a problem has a solution and you fix it. And a dilemma is built into life and you cope with it, but you don't fix it permanently. So to me, a problem is like the exhaust system on your car is dragging and you get it replaced, fixed. A dilemma is like being a parent. It's incurable. You have children, that's what we say, but you have to let them go. You love them, but they drive you nuts, right? They make you feel proud and fulfilled and terrified and furious. And it's wonderful being with them. It's fabulous getting away from them. And you're not helpless. You cope. But the distinction is you don't cope once and then it's done. And anything we read as a problem, we expect it's going to be fixed. I'm going to fix it. You're going to fix it. We're going to fix it. The school's going to fix it. If it doesn't stay fixed, we wonder what went wrong and who screwed up. If we read it as a dilemma, we expect to do something constructive, but we're not surprised when we have to revisit periodically. So in every one of your schools, every 3 or 4 years, there's a ton of turnover in students, for example, and even in parents. And there's all sorts of things that have to be redone. You can't just do them once. So a topic like thinking about mental health and thinking about suicide and stuff surely qualifies as a dilemma. For me, it does anyway. So what I want to do is try to see if I can first just share some facts about the basic situation of suicide and some key factors about it, and then we'll be able to talk about things you can do, and we'll try to leave some time for questions. So I think we could all agree one suicide ever is too many. And anybody who's a parent would say one is too many. And the closer we are to it, the more we're likely to feel that way. But the reality is that suicide has always been a feature of human existence, as far back as we have records, and certainly today. And if you look at the national statistics collected by the National Institute of Mental Health and the Centers for Disease Control, what they do, and what you do here, and most Massachusetts communities do, is they collect periodic surveys from kids, and ask them about risky behaviors and things, including suicidality. And these kinds of surveys always have a methodological question, you know, the kids really saying what's true or not. But when you do it year after year after year after year, and the percentages are pretty much the same, and then you see changes if you do, you have some reason to take that sort of more seriously. Anyway, here's just a couple. Between 17 and 24% of high school kids say on these surveys that they considered suicide in the last 12 months. 14 to 18% say they made a plan about how they might attempt suicide. 8 to 9% say they tried, and just under 3% say they made an attempt that required some kind of medical intervention. Now, there's 15 million high school age kids in the country. So that means those who actually made an attempt that required some kind of medical intervention is 405,000 a year, or over 1,100 per day. Now, we're a country of 300 million people. So this is, I mean, these numbers can seem, you think, oh my God, but, you know. And you can make allowances in different ways. So the local data, which Dawn Bentley, the assistant superintendent, and I were talking about here, which I gather will be coming out soon, suggest that your numbers here are, for example, like the ones in Wellesley, where they had a small group of suicides a few years back, lower than the national average, not higher. Right? So the first thing to say is that it is a ubiquitous feature of human life, though it's by no means a majority of kids. No means. But it's not nothing or something that you think, well, this never happens. It actually does happen, and a lot more often than most people realize. Secondly, when the experts and the researchers who do this trace back the lives of those who have died by suicide in adolescence, they find some stuff pretty routinely. And here again, I'm giving you general numbers, but these crop up repeatedly. So most of the kids, and most estimates are somewhere above 80%, had a significant mental health problem or a substance abuse problem or both. So a huge percentage. And of those mental health problems, the large majority were not minor ones. They were what in my trade we often call mood disorders. So this would include manic depression, for example, manic depressive illness, and very, very serious depression, not just garden variety upset or sadness or whatever. Another factor which shows up routinely is the presence of significant, really significant, not minor, parent-child discord. Now, I want to be very clear right now that the kids who meet these criteria, most of them live long lives. The vast majority, especially when they get treatment, they live long lives. They don't kill themselves. But if you're asking what is more likely to predispose, then it would be these kinds of factors. There are other contributors too. Kids who've been victims of abuse, sexual abuse, physical abuse, and so on. Kids who were struggling with issues about sexual identity. There are lots of things that will help to contribute. But when this happens, what we're always looking for is what caused it? What's the answer? What's the cause? And the first thing to know is there's never just one. Because if there were just one, then every adolescent who was facing that would end up the same way. But you need some combination of the circumstances the child is facing and the inner workings of the child in order to produce this kind of result. Right? Now, a number of the things that are risk factors actually have a fairly strong family connection. So, for example, some of the mood disorders have a biological basis and can be transmitted that way. Once again, they can be treated, but they have that. There are also families where a child ends up with one of these diagnoses that has a biological basis, but neither parent has that. And the parents are then struggling with something that nobody can say they created. and trying to do the best they can to raise a child the best way that they possibly can. It's also true that another thing which actually can be passed on and that is another risk factor is a tendency towards impulsive aggression when frustrated or challenged. And by this, I'm not talking about a kid who has a hot temper. I was at another high school today talking about a student there who had graduated a couple of years ago and appears to have died by suicide. And the school can remember that he almost got into a physical fight with several teachers at different times during his school career. It wasn't just somebody with a little bit of temper. He was really sort of out there. So I'm citing these things not to scare you, but to say a couple of things. The first is that the causes are multiple. They're almost always involve significant internal factors, almost always. And they are not as simple as we would wish. And one dilemma I've encountered over and over in schools is, it's very different actually from about 10 or 15 years ago, is that if there is, if a student dies this way, or as here, a second boy, not just Matthew, but Tom, dies this way, at this point now, the superintendents of schools and the high school principals across the country know they're gonna get a raft of criticism. And some of it's gonna be really nasty. Some of it's gonna be just on social media. Some of it's gonna be by email. And some of it's gonna come from people around the country who know nothing about your town or your community or your school. But that there's gonna be a much greater tendency than there used to be towards saying, this is a problem, what's the school gonna do to fix it? And how could you have let this happen? So I need to say a couple things to you real clearly. Students do not kill themselves because there's too much homework. And they don't kill themselves because there's pressure at school. If that were true, the country would be littered with students who died, right? It's not that it wouldn't be good to try to do things to improve the balance of students. That's why it would be good for you to come next week and listen to Dr. Pope. It would be really good. But things that schools can't do include fixing deep-seated, biologically based mood disorders. That's actually something that requires skillful treatment. It's not something you fix in a guidance counselor's office, for example. There are things schools can do to help, but that's what it is, to help. And I think it's often very hard. I can only speak for myself. Well, that's not true. I can speak for a lot of the schools where I've been, where I've listened to people. It's so unsettling. It's so scary. It seems so unthinkable and so awful when this happens that we all look around for somebody to fix it. And we all wish somebody would. And I think what's hard to realize is that sometimes, despite everybody's best efforts, it isn't possible. Sometimes. Other times we can intervene in a way that does seem to make a difference, but not always. And I've wished for years that I'd be able to stand here and say, so I got the answer. Here's what you do. And then we won't have this anymore. But it would be dishonest to say that. I don't think it's true. So there are lots of things. I could go on for another hour and a half. You'd start feeling really bad and be sorry you came because I was just sort of painting such a grim picture, as it may seem to you. I'm not trying to do that. What I'm trying to do is give you a sort of a somewhat larger context, perhaps, for understanding when things like these two deaths happen. That's what I'm trying to do. However, there are some things that are really worth saying to you that are not rocket science. And I'm betting that a number of you may already do some of these, and so I may only be encouraging you then to do more of this or to keep it up. But there are some things that can be helpful and that are worth thinking about. So first, we say, well, what are protective factors? What are things that help ensure against a child or an adolescent reaching a place where he or she decides to try to end their life? The first thing that pops up on anybody's list is high parent-child warmth. Do you know? It's hard to think of something simpler than that. High parent-child warmth. The trouble is, you start saying things like this, and you say, well, wait a second, I'm talking about adolescence. You know? And you think to yourself, when's the last time that kid showed a shred of gratitude? When is the last time that kid stopped getting on me about something or whatever? Do you know? And there aren't lots of adolescents who get up in the morning and say, I'd like to have a nice warm conversation with you before I go to school. And as soon as I come home, if we could have another warm conversation, I'd be really grateful, right? So that's not what it means, having to do that. But in fact, one challenge that we face, especially in high-achieving, high-performing communities, is that we tend over time to focus increasingly on the child and the adolescent as a performer, a producer, a competitor, right? And in terms of what she or he can accomplish and how they can outdo others. And when we do that, I mean, every parent needs to do some of that. Our kids have to grow up and take their place in the world. But the more we focus on that, the more we squeeze out other things. So what we squeeze out is what used to be Mr. Rogers. Now, not all of you here know Mr. Rogers, but many of you do. He's long dead now, but he was in many ways the most nurturing presence in late 20th century American public life. You know, you never had to do anything for Mr. Rogers to like you. You didn't have to be intelligent, good-looking, athletic, nice. You could be ugly, uncoordinated, mean, and dumb. Be 5:30 in the afternoon when your mother could wring your little neck and he'd come out on the TV and put on his sweater and the sneakers and feed the fish and sing to you. But here's the deal. He liked to be with the kids. He liked to be with you, and he didn't need you to be better than somebody else at something to be worth his interest. So are we going to abandon the competitive emphasis now? Of course not. Would it be good now and then to moderate it a little? Probably. Probably. So I'm going to ask you to do me a favor right this minute, all of you. I want you to pick one of your children. If you have more than one, pick a child. Think about something about that child that you treasure, that you just love. Makes you laugh, or it makes you proud, or just something. All right? You all got it? Okay. I want you to turn to the person next to you, and if you've come here with somebody you know well, like someone who helped you produce or bear children, you want to turn the other way, speak to someone you don't, and we have no time for introductions. Just say something I love about, and you name the child, is, and say two sentences. Just two sentences. Right? Go ahead. We'll do it real quick. Real quick. Did you say something? Right here. Okay. Time is short, which is why I'm stopping you. So the question that follows is this. When's the last time you told the kid? Right? Think about it. Tell him. Tell her. Second, a strongly protective factor, not surprisingly, is what the researchers call family cohesion. And this obviously means families who sort of cohere together. Now, this does not require that people never get divorced. Even if there is a divorce, or there's a single parent, or whatever, what it means is, within that universe, is there basic cohesion around this child? There are many people who never divorce, and there's very little cohesion in the family. There are some people who divorce and go on to separate lives, but there is cohesion about the raising of the kids, some basic agreements about the kids. And the kids know beyond question that there are pieces of the parental caretaking that are shared. Now, we can't always arrange this the way we would like, and adolescents have a real gift for driving a wedge between parents. Because this boy you've got here, you thought he was nifty, but you know, he's 14 and he's starting to be a little more like his father. And his father seemed exciting when you first were dating. But it turns out he's a little reckless and he's not so good on the follow through. And so you're no longer just dealing with the boy, but with the father, in a way, right? So it's easy to say, cohere, cohere. But the point here is not coherence doesn't mean like, you know, everything's perfect, we're all buddy-buddy, we never argue, we never disagree, any of that. What it means is it's kept within some bounds and there's a kind of basic coherence to the parenting unit when it comes to raising the kid. Third, it turns out to be very helpful for all sorts of things, not just tonight's topic, if the kids experience relatively consistent discipline. Relatively consistent discipline. What does that mean? It means that we're not afraid to say to them things like, no, you can't, and yes, you must. And that we're willing to explain ourselves once or twice, but not more than three times. I want you to imagine this. You explain to your son why he can't, or to your daughter why she must, and the child objects, okay? You repeat your explanation, adding a few details to confirm its logic. The child objects. Now you flesh it out in full technicolor so the reasonableness of your rationale would be clear to the dumbest creature on God's green earth. And the child objects. So the buzzer ought to go off in your head that says, if I repeat this a fourth time, what are the odds that this kid is suddenly going to say, oh, now I get it. Thank you for persevering. Sometimes all you can say is, I'm sorry, I haven't convinced you, but it's not negotiable. It's what we do in our family. And I can tell you that pediatricians, psychologists, teachers have seen abundant evidence in recent years of a huge decline in parental willingness to do this. And the dilemma is that it doesn't help the kids develop inner resources. For example, the resource, I don't like this, but I can do it because I have to. Many of you learned this growing up, right? Every Sunday, we had to go to my father's mother, my grandmother. And apart from the fact that I was her favorite, it was a drag. And I had to go from church in my itchy woolen suit, and but I learned over time the stuff you just have to do. And one of the ways we help build resilience and coping in kids is by being clear, not about 85 rules, but basic non-negotiables around the growing up of the child. So what this requires is a willingness for them not to like you. Because it's not fair to say, you can't do that, or you have to do this, and you can't dislike me. They have to be allowed to dislike you, because what they have to learn to do is to be like you. Let me ask you this. Your kids have finally gone too far, and you really had to finally say, that's enough, whatever. Ask yourself. You've almost always spoken to them in someone else's tone of voice, often the same phrases, and it's either your mother or your father. Even if, like me, you swore you'd never do that, you've heard yourself say the same things. This is how we pass culture on. So if they're 18, it's late to get started, but it doesn't hurt. But what you have to realize is that some investment in clear limits about what's not negotiable in your family is a way to strengthen the inner resources of your adolescents as they, your children first, and then your adolescents as they grow up. It's helpful also, turns out, to have good parental monitoring. I always, you know, I read these things and I think, do any of you people have adolescents when you write this? But here's what they mean by it. Years and years ago, 20 plus years ago, I read a big piece of research which said that there's one way to make sure that kids are in a much safer category in terms of any kind of risky behavior. And what it involved was this, that in adolescence, their parents know where they are and their parents know their friends. Not the names of their friends, the friends. So I read this and I'm thinking, so? What's that? Everybody knows that. Well, it turned out, in fact, small numbers of people know that. Not large numbers of people know that. When you were growing up and you were adolescents, did you not have to tell your parents where you were going to be? And if they checked up on you and you weren't there, were you not in some kind of trouble? Right? You need to trust me. There are large numbers of kids today whose parents have no idea where they are and who have heard some of the names. So this morning, Joanne and I, your principal, Dr. Campbell and I, we were at a meeting of other principals, and one of them was talking about walking down the hall in her school and hearing two girls, students, talking. And the one said, the seniors, the one said to the other, my dad said last night, so who are your friends? And I thought, you know, you're way late. I mean, she's a senior in high school. Your kids don't want to tell you the names of their friends and bring them to the house for you to meet. Well, that may make a difference about whether they go out. You have a right to inspect. I don't mean to, you know, you have a right to say. You know, you have a right to say, I want to meet your friends. I just want to know who they are. Bring them to the house, whatever. And you're allowed to go here and there and the other until your time to be home, but I need to know where you are. This may sound really simple to you. It actually is fairly simple. You'd be amazed these days how rare it is. So the monitoring means that the kids know, even when they say, go away, butt out, they don't mean that far. And if you're a little too intrusive, that's okay. However, what's not helpful is to follow them around and pepper them with questions. Aren't you upset today, dear? Didn't something go wrong at school today, dear? Wasn't there something you didn't get in history class today, dear? Is there anything else you're worried about, dear? This is a way to drive them into the cellar or into the attic or somewhere, I don't know. You don't have to do that. What is helpful about that goes with the monitoring is the being available. Some of you came when Maria Trossi was here a couple weeks ago. Some of you were here, no? But you can see that video on the school site as well. And she talked about this also. What's really great to help with adolescents is not to force them to talk, but to be ready when they are ready. And she said during her thing, I'm talking to you dads. So I guess I should say, I'm talking to you dads, not just to the moms. And here's what I mean. There are some times that are excellent. If they're not driving yet, or even if they are, but you're driving in the car, everybody's looking straight ahead. An excellent time to have a short conversation. No eye contact required. Right? Your kid says something to you that raises the hackles on the back of your neck about something, especially after all this when everybody's going to be extra, you know, nervous about it. And you don't know, what do I say? Are you thinking about killing yourself? Are you depressed? Are you... So you want to know what you can do that's good. Here's what you do. You say, oh. Or you say, oh. Or you say, oh. 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 It's amazing what you can get if you don't say anything but oh, or occasionally, really, really. Because what you're doing is you're saying this. Just tell me a little more. What did you mean by that? Your kid comes home and says, I'm so depressed. The coach is playing kids ahead of me who are nowhere near as good as I am. You can say, let me get on the phone and talk to the coach. Or you can say, oh, tell me about that. You listen a little, and then you say something like, what do you think you're going to do? Kid has no idea or a bad idea, help him out, help her out. If you race to fix it all, you'll smooth their path right now, but you won't be helping them build resources as copers. And one of the ways you can both engage with them without forcing things is to be ready to respond, and if ever you're buffaloed, just say, oh. or some version of, could you tell me a little more, or what were you thinking about, or anything that would do this. Because when there has been a tragedy, when there's any kind of a death, it's like a rip in the fabric. And one of the things that's most comforting about it is simply the renewal of connection. So you rarely have to worry about saying just the right thing. You don't have to worry about that. You're available, you do your best, right? And when the kids see that happening, they feel comforted. Kid says to you, why do you think somebody would do that? And you can say, gee, did you have a thought about that? What were you thinking about, right? And they tell you a couple of sentences, you say, you know, I wonder that too. Sometimes it's so hard when we don't have an answer. And they say, okay, and they get some cereal out of the cupboard. And what you've had is a couple of minutes of connection, which actually is very helpful. And there's one last thing that I want to say, which is this. It's the corollary to what I just asked you a couple of minutes ago. One of the biggest troubles we've had, in my view, that has made parenting much harder is there's an endless raft of advice books, most of which are not worth the paper they're written on, and that keep telling parents, do this, do that, do the other, watch out for this, your kids are fragile, etc. Even though it may be hard to believe right now, most kids are mostly resilient without any fancy training or preparation. Most kids. All kids have fragile moments. Some kids are truly fragile. Most are not. And so part of what this means is that you don't have to be perfect. You need to be the best of who you are. And one of the trouble with all the advice books is they don't know you and they don't know your kid. Now, my experience about these advice books is there's two kinds of parents. There's parents who read them, parents who don't. Stand to reason. And the parents who do read these advice books are often upset that their husbands won't. So I want to put in a word for the dads. You come here tonight with some advice books you haven't read, don't. Pick the book up, thumb through it, estimate the time it would take you. Divide that by the number of kids you have, if it's three or fewer. And spend a little time with each kid alone doing something you and she or you and he would like to do. Not because it'll improve her or him. You'll get a better result than if you read more books and try to turn yourself into something else that you're not, right? And what's really, what the books often leave out is this. Most of us have a really hard time being very different from who we are. So here's the last thing I want to ask you. Virtually every way of being a parent, no matter what your culture, no matter what your background, no matter how you do it, almost every way has strengths and weaknesses. And they're like this. You can't, right? So let's say hypothetically as a parent, you're a tense, anxious, nervous worrier. You know, you hover, you inquire, you ask, you check up. You're out in the kitchen doing something. The kids are in the other room in front of screens. It occurs to you, you forgot to speak to them. You turn to go. You haven't left yet, but your aura has preceded you out. And in front of the screens, they're twitching nervously in front of. Well, that's not good. On the other hand, stuff may not fall between the cracks in your house. By contrast, you may be relaxed and laid back, and your kids may love it. But they may ride roughshod over each other. You can't read a book that'll give you the best of both and none of the weaknesses. What to do? Be the best of who you are. So here's the other question. I want each of you to be good enough to indulge me to think quickly some piece of parenting that you are really good at. And I don't care if it's little or general. And I want you to tell somebody else real quickly in a couple of sentences something I'm good at as a parent is. Okay? Real quick. Just a quick couple minutes. Come on. There you go. You two again. Good. All done? All done? Okay. So I'm stopping you again because time is short, but also because I've learned over the years, if you let this go 3 minutes, a disappointing number of people have started talking about something they're not good at. So, you know, we can laugh, but here's the part that's not so good. You have no idea how many parents there are in schools of your quality who have kids who are really doing well and are full of promise, and where the parents keep thinking about how empty the glass is. And the people in the schools know, you can check me on this, what the impact is on kids who grow up doing well, but parents never think it's good enough. It's grim. So I'm not urging you to be lazy and like that. What I'm saying is, if you're gonna have the high standards and the high expectations, you need to not lose sight of what you're doing well, right? If you're not sure what to do, here's what you do. Tonight, you get home, take a piece of paper, draw a line down the middle, write down what you just said. Put below it all your other strengths. The right side, start putting down your weaknesses as a parent. Get to three, stop writing. You'll probably notice the three are the flip side of your strengths. Tear it along the middle. Put the weaknesses face down under the largest pile you're accumulating. Don't consult it before April. Put the strengths somewhere where you see it every day, and not every day, but now and then, ask yourself, how will I do a little more of one of them? If you have no idea what your strengths are, ask your kid. You say something like, I've been wondering what you really admire about me. I know, I'm sorry, it's goofy. I don't mean that. Anyway, but the long and short of it is this. One of the ways that you actually help protect kids as they grow up and keep them safe is to not just be fixated on what else, what else, what else, but to be able to also think about the Mr. Rogers stuff and what they're like as people and what you treasure about them and what's going well. It may not seem like much to you, but it's an investment in protection for your kids. Now, I could go on for another 3 hours. We wouldn't have come close to exhausting all this, and you're not here for that. So I may have already said something that seemed weird to you, or I should apologize for, or I didn't get near something you were concerned about, and we won't have time for everybody, but we'll do the best we can. So questions, objections, things I should backtrack, please. I'm going to try to repeat it so people can. So the question, if I got it right, is, what do we do about the fact that we need to help our middle school and high school kids think about their future and their place in the world and how they can be prepared for that and that kind of thing, right?
And that we have these conversations probably all the time.
Conversations all the time. So the first thing I would recommend is not having those conversations. No, I'm quite serious. I don't think any 13-year-old ought to know what she's going to become or do. If she does, it's okay with me. It's not likely to be all that helpful to her to have to answer questions about stuff she cannot even imagine.
What if they bring it up to you, though?
Well, then you say, oh. No, I'm serious. You say, here's what you do. If they bring it up to you, you always want to know, where does it come from? That's the point of the O. You say, gee, what made you ask? What were you thinking about? Because you don't know whether she's bringing it up to you because she's worried that she's going to be letting you down if she becomes a nurse, or that she wants to become something she doesn't think she's going to be able to get, or somebody said something to her that made her feel bad. And you know, if you ask a little, you just sort of say, and the other thing that happens is the conversation flows a little more naturally. If what you have to do is initiate this kind of stuff, you keep the kids in the one down position. What am I going to say? I don't know. I mean, I didn't know what I wanted to do when I was 13 or 14 or 16. I knew when I was 18, but I didn't know when I was then. And kids who live extremely successful lives as adults, some of them don't discover it till they're 30 or beyond. So I would worry less about initiating, and if they do, I would only want to sort of respond in a way that would kind of draw them out a little, and then you'll know what question you're really answering, right? Plus, it'll be a lot easier on you. No, I'm serious. If you have to answer literally everything an adolescent asks you, I mean, you, It's exhausting.
I think sometimes the struggle, though, and I just one more thing.
You got to go right to the point, not the anecdote, because there's other people. So give me the guts.
Well, they're putting that pressure on.
You know, I don't know what to say, because I hear parents say all the time, "I'm not putting that pressure on." You may not be overtly. But I know all sorts of people who say they're not putting any pressure on them, but they're such high achievers that a kid growing up and just looking around is unlikely to feel it would be okay to be anything but that. I don't know your child. No, I don't know your child. I don't know you. I don't know a lot of adolescents who are dwelling on that. And if there's something that really is eating at her repeatedly, I would want to find a way to talk with her about how come this comes up so often, what she's thinking about. I might want to talk to the counselor at school about it, see what she's saying there and asking about it, you know, if she is or not, because you'd get some more context, and then you're going to know better how to respond. It's nice that she's conscientious. That's really good. It just, you know, just don't want it to overdo it and have her worry too much about what she's going to become. I've just stunned the rest of you. Oh, no, good. Please.
Yeah.
So it's a very good question. Thank you. The closer anybody is, whether it's an adult or an adolescent, to someone who's died by suicide, the more the impact is likely to be. So there are several things to say that are especially true about adolescents more than about us. They can be very upset in the immediate. They typically recover faster than we do because some things go on irresistibly for teenagers. The hormones are still pumping. The social stuff is still going on. And most kids, even those who get very upset, recover, and they often do more rapidly than adults do. The ones we worry about are ones where the reaction isn't for a couple of days or a week or two, but it goes on. And there's a consistent difference. She's not sleeping, she's not eating, consistent difference in her behavior. She's talking about it all the time. So in that case, I want to call the school and say, are you seeing this there? And what kind of special help can we get for her, which is usually going to need to be outside of school. She needs that. And you know, a lot of times all you can do when someone says what she said to you, which is perfectly natural, you can say, it's awfully hard, isn't it? It's worrisome, isn't it? And she can say, well, are you worried? And you say, yeah, I worry too. And that may not seem like making her secure, because you're not saying, don't worry. But when you say, don't worry to somebody who's worried, right? Whereas if you say, I can see why you might be worried, they feel it's actually more secure because they've connected with you. And what they often need is not details about the words you use, but the feeling of the connection, right? And when you're able to do that with them, even just a few minutes, a couple of minutes of conversation, and then a few days, another couple of minutes or whatever, this is often very helpful to them. And I wouldn't worry so much about trying to reassure. And I would want more to listen if I could and say, oh, and what made you think of that? And I see, well, I've wondered that too. Have you talked to anybody else about that? If you find yourself continuing to be worried, you know, you're not sleeping, you're so you need to talk to somebody in school and see if they are seeing the same thing. If not, that's a good sign. They are seeing it, they can help you think about getting some help for her. Oh, sorry, please. Okay, if you all didn't hear that, what do you do if you have a teenager who doesn't want to talk to you, you have an inkling they're depressed or something, but they say no, and you don't want to, I believe as she put it, annoy the crap out of them, right? Good for you. So can I ask what you have done? You could tell somebody if they asked you what it is that she's doing or saying that makes you nervous. You know what that is? And you've told her that?
Yes.
Good. And she says no?
She says I'm fine.
Okay. So depending on how worried you are, you have a couple of options. One, you can wait and watch and see. Two, you can also check and see if they're seeing anything at school. Because if they are, I always pay greater attention because you're both seeing it, right? If not, that's often encouraging. Or they're going to start keeping their eyes on her and give you some input. You can ask the pediatrician if you want, sort of think about it. And if finally you can't stand up, you would have to think of a way and a place to be able to say to her, so I know we've gone around and around about this, and you're probably tired of me doing it. So I just need to tell you, here's what makes me worried. And I just want you to listen to me, and then I'll listen to you. And then you can say, so okay, that, I hear what you're telling me. So the other thing I need to know is that if you ever really did feel as bad as I was worried about, you'd come to me. And I need to believe that so I can stop bothering you. No, you say it just like that. I need you to tell me, I need to believe that so I can stop bothering you about it. She says, okay, good. Things are quiet for 6 weeks. And after Christmas, you get worried again. You know, you may get to a place where you feel you have to say to her, no, we have to go get an opinion from somebody because I know you keep saying it, but I'm too worried. Right now, it's hard not to be spooked, right? So you're naturally going to be a little more sensitive to it. But I am always concerned when whatever I'm seeing continues and it's different from what used to be as compared to something that's just different right now, even if it's very upset, but it fades in a week or two and so on. Okay? Please. So you're supporting the notion of staying in touch with the school if you're worried about your kid being depressed. They might see that a little differently. No, but this actually is a problem because actually many schools have been grappling for a good while with parents who do over-communicate about things the school sees as hangnails. And it's kind of hard to say, that's your 14th email this month, please don't send us any more, right? No, but I'm serious. But if you get a sense that it seems like too much or whatever, it would be better to, first of all, these topics are really, really good not to do by email. Don't send the school an email with four paragraphs of your concern about your daughter. Call them up. The chances for misunderstanding are too great on the email. And the way to connect about it and to have your child have that kind of personal linkage is to talk personally if you're really concerned. Or if you happen to, let's say I'm at the school and you've had three kids go through, I've known you for 10 years. Okay, that's a little different because we speak the same language and we trust each other. But otherwise, this is really good to do person to person and not indirectly when you have a real concern of some kind. Sorry. You don't have to hang out with them. They just have to. Yeah, you say, you bring their sorry asses in here. No, I'm serious. You say this. You know, I'm not butting into your social life. I just want to know who your friends are. I never see them. I don't even know their names. You know, here's a thought. Why don't we'll have pizza or something, bring them over. I just want to meet them. I just want to say hello, whatever. They come in and you think to yourself, oh, no. Oh. Right, that's very different than if they turn out to be delightful kids, you know, and you're going to feel better about it. And you don't have to follow them around and all that stuff. But all I'm saying is it was not so much that you have to know all of them, but that if you don't know any of them, it's just interesting that it turns out it doesn't mean your child is going to get into any difficulty by himself or herself. But as a group, they're safer when parents know who their friends are, actually know the friends. Not like buddies, but know the friends. That's right. So don't embarrass me. So I have a colleague at my clinic, and her granddaughter was going out to the prom, and father was going to drive them. And on the way, he was driving her, and they were going to meet at the prom. Anyway, on the way, she says to him, now, we get in there. I don't want you even talking to him. I don't, whatever. So they get in there, the thing, and the young man comes right over to meet her father and puts out his hand, and the father's thinking, all right, you know. What can you say? I'm sorry. I know I'm terrible. I'm just embarrassing, aren't I? You just need to tolerate about 5 minutes of it. Just 5 minutes of it. He wants to know why you want to do that. You say, well, because I'll feel better. I'll feel better if I just know a little tiny bit of see your friends. That's all. And I'm not trying to pretend that this fixes everything. It's just an indicator. So you can decide about it. There may be other ways in which you monitor your children. And so you're confident about where they are and what they're doing and who they're doing it with? Fine. Be good. We only have time for a couple more because the school committee I know has to meet. Well, I mean, you can, you know, how to respond to it when the kids say the school isn't doing anything and kids are dying. So first of all, I suppose you can't defend a whole lot if you don't really know about it. I have to say, you know, that adolescents are prone to fierce overreactions. And most of this stuff tends to dwindle away. You can say, what do you want them to do? What would you like them to do? She says, I'd like them to do X, Y, and Z. Well, does she want to go speak to somebody about that and ask them, would they consider that or why haven't they? So I'll give you a for instance. One of the things some kids and some parents sometimes say is, well, you know, if something like this happens, you ought to get the whole school together, you ought to go on the PA and announce it. This is a really bad idea. It's contraindicated in every protocol for responding to suicide. The vast majority of kids in the high school rarely know the student who's dead because some of them just got there this fall and, you know. Secondly, you don't want to make impersonal announcements when you don't have your eyes on kids you think might be, you know, upset or whatever. Well, she could go and say that and somebody could explain it to her, if that's what she thought, I mean. She might not, I don't know. But, I mean, it's not a bad thing to say, well, what do you want them to do? And have you spoken to somebody about that? Why don't you do that and let me know? And she can come in and say to somebody, what about it? And they can say, well, that's a good idea, or no, we don't want to do, we thought about that, but we didn't do it on purpose or whatever. So I think it's really good not to try to put in the position of yourself of having to defend or explain stuff you can't vouch for. And it's nice not to cut her off, but it's also nice not to say, oh, well, I see that's really a big problem. Let's get on the stick about that. But I would like to, it'd be good for her to think it through, tell you what she wants, and think about what she wants to say about it. You'd be willing to listen to that, wouldn't you? No. Yes, you would. Okay. One more, please. Your son's a senior, yeah? So you have found it helpful to say, here's what the school is doing, how they're communicating with us, et cetera. Right. So I think, you know, between now and Thanksgiving and sort of thereafter, a lot of this stuff will be clearer. It'll be easier to be organized about some of the other events that are going to happen. I mean, they're starting as early as next week with more planned after that, I'm sure. And so some of this is going to get a lot clearer and the kids are likely to calm down about it. If that turns out, giving him those answers turns out to be helpful to him, all the better. Because the basic rule with adolescents is if it works, do it. It doesn't matter what some guy in the front of the room says. If your kid's different and it works with your kid, by all means, do it. You know? And don't stand on ceremony about it. So the last thing I want to say, I'm happy to hang around here, but I know the school committee has to meet and some of you have to get home and stuff because of the time we promised. So the last thing is, I think I want to say is this. With dilemmas like this, there is not, as I suggested at the outset, a cure. That is where we can know it's never going to happen again. We'd have to rewire the human brain for that to be possible. So nobody here tonight, certainly not I, none of us can say, well, it's never going to happen again here. God knows we hope that it doesn't. And all we can do is do our best. And one of the things that always happens in the wake of this is I think it makes every one of us, even a stranger who doesn't live here, think, you know, what have I been taking for granted? And how precious are my kids to me? And what if something happened and all that kind of stuff? It's only normal kind of human whatever. And sometimes it makes us do things we wish we didn't or we can't resist. And usually what happens is we learn and grow. And the worst thing in life is not to suffer. It's to suffer and not learn. And one of the lessons that all of your kids have to learn is that one. Even though we all wish we didn't have to teach them that, right? And, you know, what's going to distinguish your sons and daughters as they grow up is not whether they run into loss and disappointment and frustration and failure even, but what they do when those things happen. And if we could insulate them the way we often wish from all of that, their path as adolescents would be smoother, but we wouldn't be preparing them for the path of life. And so though none of us wants to arrange these things for the kids, it is true that there are ways in which even awful losses can help people learn and grow. That's why English teachers, which I once was, make your kids read poems and plays and novels. That's what they're about, loss and learning. And they're the hardest things in life sometimes to put together. But if I said to all of you, please think right now, about the deepest, most profound lessons you have learned in your life and how you learned them. The odds are overwhelming that you learned them in a context of loss or disappointment or failure. And we all wish we didn't have to do that, but that's how life works. And the good news is that the vast majority of kids cope. The vast majority cope. It's hard to feel that way at a time like this, but it really is true. So I hope you'll think of coming back next week and staying in touch with the school and so on, and remembering that they, like you, are hurting every bit as much, and working, despite what some of your kids may think, as hard as they can to do what needs to be done. And I'm so glad that the other organizations were able to be with us tonight, because this kind of stuff is not a schools to fix. This is collective to fix. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Rob. On behalf of the Acton-Boxborough community, thank you for your time. Just two things before you depart. On the table on the way out the door, there are two yellow sheets. One, a recap of the or an upcoming family learning series. If you haven't had a chance to pick this up, I would certainly encourage you to do so. It lists all of some terrific sessions that have been planned throughout the course of the rest of this year, not just with Dr. Denise Pope next Tuesday, but Maria Trazzi and many others that will take place in the winter. If you haven't noticed yet, there is a theme that was very deliberate in pulling these together back in starting the summer, actually last spring, around social emotional well-being, and that's a theme that certainly ties them together. The other is a document two-sided, put together by Rob on and around adolescence, suicide, and prevention. Thanks again for coming. A reminder that this will be videotaped and replayed. It'll be available probably in a couple of weeks. Thank you.